Good morning and welcome to Reading the Gospels Together for April the 1st. Today we're looking at Matthew chapters 3 and 4. Chapter 3 introduces us to John the Baptist. All four of the Gospels spend a lot of time on John, with Luke even giving us the story of his birth. Matthew doesn't go into quite as much detail, but he paints a picture for us nonetheless. Matthew ties John into the Old Testament with a quote from Isaiah 40 verse 3. A voice of one crying in the wilderness, "Prepare the way for the Lord." But there's another tie to the Old Testament, John's clothing. Matthew and Mark both point out that John wore distinctive clothing made of camel's hair and a leather belt around his waist. This is more than fashion commentary. It identifies John as a successor to the prophet Elijah, who's described in the Old Testament as being known for dressing similarly. Elijah was expected to return from heaven, to where he was taken in a chariot of fire to announce the coming of the Messiah. Pious Jews to this very day leave a chair vacant at Passover, the Elijah chair, as a reminder of this expectation. Interestingly, the place where John is conducting his baptisms is exactly where Elijah was said to have been taken to heaven. Ever wonder about his strange diet of locusts and honey? It's another tie-in to Elijah, who relied upon the miraculous provision of food by God. Locusts and wild honey, notice not cultured honey, but wild honey, were not reliable seasonal crops. They came by happenstance and were regarded as direct provisions of God. John, like Elijah, relied entirely upon God for his food. And yes, locusts are kosher. John was baptizing people as a sign of their repentance and new life. Ritual bathing for spiritual cleansing was widely practiced at the time. The pools of Bethesda and Siloam are two of the large community pools for ritual bathing mentioned in the New Testament. There are also many hundreds of much smaller ritual baths called mikveh throughout the country. A large community of Jewish men called the Essenes is found close to John's baptism area in a place called Qumran, now famous for the location of the Dead Sea Scrolls. They were very serious about ritual immersions for spiritual purity. We also have in the Dead Sea Scrolls examples of their teaching, some of which sounds a lot like John the Baptist. Many scholars think John spent time there. John's preaching and baptism caused quite a religious revival across Israel and set the scene for Jesus, who himself was baptized by John. Famously, when Jesus went up out of the water, the Holy Spirit alighted upon him, and God spoke from heaven, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." Jesus immediately went into the wilderness to be tempted, another process of spiritual preparation for his ministry. When you read wilderness in the Bible, don't think forests and swamps. Think sharp hills and mountains, rocks and desert. Jesus is there for 40 days and nights, and that is a significant number. In the story of Noah, it rained for 40 days and nights to cleanse the earth. Moses spends 40 days and nights fasting on Mount Sinai, receiving instruction and commandments from God. The Israelites spent 40 years wandering the desert until they were ready to enter the promised land, and so on. Do a search on the word 40 in the Bible, and you'll be amazed at how often it's tied to significant events. The temptations, stones to bread, throw yourself from the temple, worship the devil and gain the kingdoms of the world, all question Jesus' identity and mission. To turn stones to bread would imply relying upon his own power and not the provision of God, even as the wandering nation had to rely upon manna. To throw yourself from the temple, confident that you are impervious, you would not be harmed, would be to undermine the vulnerability of Jesus, so central to his mission. Jesus would prove himself very open to vulnerability and suffering, as Easter week so passionately illustrates. And to gain the cities of the world, if he would worship the devil, first of all, the world is not the devil's to give, and secondly, such a shortcut to power, while so attractive to the people of this world, is not the path of Jesus, who would worship only God. Having survived the temptations in the desert and thereby proving his worth, Jesus now enters his ministry years. He's 30 years old, the age at which a rabbi can begin teaching. John the Baptist has been imprisoned, so the mantle has now fallen to Jesus, whose first sermon in Matthew 4:17 is identical to John's in Matthew 3:2. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. The preparation is complete, and the ministry begins. Matthew sums up what that ministry looks like at the end of chapter 4. Like John's, it has an impact throughout the country, but unlike John's, it spreads into the Gentile regions as well. Tomorrow we'll be reading chapters 5 and 6, the famous Sermon on the Mount, Matthew's collection and summary of the main points of Jesus' teaching. It begins with the Beatitudes, the Latin word for blessings. What do you think that word really means? In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus often says, "You have heard, but I say." How does Jesus' teaching affect the traditional commandments? Chapter 6 has the Lord's Prayer. Look closely at verses 14 and 15. Do you think they should be part of the prayer too? How would that change the way we think about the prayer? And then chapter 6 concludes with Jesus teaching us not to worry. A more useful passage for us today it would be hard to imagine. Read this portion more than once and let it sink in. That's it for today. We'll see you tomorrow.